work in collaboration with Martin Treze. University of Tours. It deals with complete, embedded, minimal surfaces with in R3 with infinitely many horizontal planar ends. Okay, all of you know a famous family of examples of this type is the family of Riemann examples. A Riemann example can be imagined as a collection of infinitely many planes, horizontal planes, with an egg joining each couple of near planes. Okay. Here is a natural question. Let me denote this plane by pi plus 1, this one by pi k minus 1, and pi minus 2. Okay, is it possible to construct a family of examples where f of nk number of necks joining pi k and pi k plus 1. So the natural question is it possible to construct an example of this type where nk is bigger than 1 for some k in Z, possibly for k in a in E, where E is an infinite set of indices. Okay. Martin Treze in the past gave a positive answer to this question in two special cases. The first one is triply periodic surfaces. In particular, he constructed, he showed that, showing the existence of embedded minimal surfaces in a flat torus T given by the quotient of R3 by a lattice lambda having genus bigger or equal to 3. In another work, he showed the existence of simply periodic embedded minimal surfaces with planar ends. In particular, he studied the case where the sequence in K, K in Z is periodic. Okay. Today I will present a work where we show the existence of surfaces of this type, which in general are not periodic. So in particular, MK is not periodic. We are able to show the existence of minimal surfaces with infinitely many horizontal parallel ends and finite genus, and two, minimal surfaces of the same type and infinite genus. For example, let's suppose to be able to add a neck, a second neck here. So we have for this value of k, n k equal to 2, and n k equal to 1 for all other values of k. We obtain a surface whose genus is 1, n k minus 1. Which is the general formula for the genus. If we are able to construct a family or an example of this type with nk and x, the genus is the genus is given by 1 plus the sum for k in Z such that nk is bigger than 1. This is the general formula. So if we have a finite set of indices for which nk is bigger than 1, we are in this case. And if nk is bigger than 1 for a set of indices which is infinite, we are in this case. Sorry?
I don't think it's 1 plus
S,
it's
0.
It's just a sum.
Ah, sorry, you're right. Excuse me. Thank you. Okay. Okay, let me explain the idea of the construction. We use a technique called opening of the nodes of a singular Riemann surface. Okay. For each k in Z, we consider a copy of the Riemann sphere with a denoted by Sk. We place on Sk nk points. So, since Sk can be seen as C union infinity, I will draw essentially a plane. So I will place on Sk nk points, pk1, pk2, pk3. This is sk. Consider another copy of sk. I will denote it by sk plus 1. And we identify these three points with the same points in sk plus 1. We do that for each k in z. So the result is a non-compact Riemann surface, which is singular because it has these double points, also known as nodes. You have infinitely many copies of the Riemann sphere. We do that for each k in z. Okay. We construct a minimal immersion, we denote it x0, of sigma 0 in R3. In this way, oops. For x prime, z prime in SK, x 0 of x prime, z prime equal x prime, z prime, 0 in our chain. X0, I repeat, is a minimal immersion of this singular Riemann surface. Okay, we want to desingularize sigma 0. So the plan is desingularization of sigma 0. In particular, we will obtain a one-parameter family of non-singular Riemann surfaces, where x is in 0, x0, with x0 small. And at the same time, a family of minimal immersion of the surface sigma x in R3. Okay. The minimal immersion x small x will be defined in terms of the Weiss data, so real parts of phi1, p2, p3, where phi I are differential forms. On sigma x, and as you know very well, these three differential forms have to satisfy some conditions. The first one is, for each a simple closed car in H1 sigma x, you have that real part. Has to vanish. That means that the immersion is well defined. So this quadratic differential forms has to vanish. That means that the immersion is minimal. I will call them conformality equation, and that implies that the immersion is minimal. 3, phi 1 modulus of phi 1 square plus modulus of phi 2 square plus phi 3 square. Positive, that means that there are no branch points. So the immersion is regular. Let me explain the procedure we use to desingularize sigma 0. I told that we place on each SK a certain number of points. The location of these points is not arbitrary. In fact, if we call this set configuration, okay. This configuration has to satisfy two conditions. The first one is the balance condition. And the second one is the non-degeneracy condition. Okay, as for the first one, I denote by F Ki the force exerted on the point PKI by all the points in SK plus 1 and minus 1. So each point here interacts with the points in SK plus 1 and with the points in SK minus 1. And by points in and by PKG with G different from E. For example, PK1 interacts with PK2 and PK3. We have an algebraic expression for these forces. I think it's very long, so I will not give it to you. A configuration is balanced. if f ki, sorry, vanishes for all k, all I. This is a necessary condition. The point pki have to satisfy this condition. So we cannot choose them arbitrarily. Unfortunately, the definition of the correct definition of non-degeneracy is complicated, but I cannot avoid to give it. Okay. I have to introduce new notation. Okay, we have pk. Okay, pk is a mean of the pki. It's a sort of center of gravity. We have pk minus 1 and uk minus, e, given by pki minus pki.
You're using the group structure of the complex.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I see all this point on the same copy of. Sorry, but I have to give this formula. Gk, ck. I introduce big U. Okay, big U is the collection of all the UK, all the UKI, with the exception of the last one. I do not consider UK and K. I consider UK and K minus 1. I introduce big G. G is the collection of all the G, so GH, FH1, FH, NH minus 1, GH plus 1, etc. So G is the collection of all the GK and the forces with the exception of the last one. Again.
Flashback, what is CK?
Sorry?
What is CK?
GK.
CK.
Ah. Excuse me. Sorry. Do you want the formula?
Can you find the formula online?
No, it's easy. But I know it by heart. Okay, this is the theorem coming from the point the points located on SK. Okay. PK1, PK2, PK3. I have not understood your question.
Force of what?
Closed
curve. Force caught?
Closed curve.
Oh, closed curve. Yeah. Closed curve.
No, it's a force.
It's like what?
It's like a force interval.
This notion has been introduced by Douady. I don't know the details behind that.
It's kind of
electricity. Essentially, you have to look at them as an electrostatic force. Imagine that PKI is an electric charge. The force exerted by the points at the same level are the opposite of attractive?
Yeah, so attractive.
No, I don't remember the English word for the contrary.
Attractive, repulsive.
Repulsive, okay. Okay, and the term which comes from the points on SK plus 1 and on SK minus 1 is attractive because you have the minus sign. Essentially,
and the difference is like a distance, right?
Yes.
A vector.
Essentially, catenoidal max placed at same level repulse themselves, and catenoidal necks at the k minus one level and at k plus one level attract themselves. One of the reasons for which we gave these two definitions is that U and G are in a Banach space noted by L infinity Z. L infinity Z is the Banach space of the infinite bilateral sequences Sk such that the norm of S super Sk is finite. This is a Banach space. Sorry?
For the Riemann's minimal surfaces, what is that K, the force? Is it
K factor? You only have one point in each plane. So there's no pulsive force.
And sorry?
There's no force at different
angles.
You have one point.
Sorry?
You prends un point, il n'y a pas de force.
Oui?
Tu prends un point là, il n'y a pas de force
entre les deux. Non, ils sont trop loin.
Ils sont trop loin, ouais. Même à deux à un niveau différent.
Non. The point on SK. The point on SK interacts with the points on SK minus 1. Yes. 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 Okay. Okay, let's consider the map F tilde associating U to G. Okay. The configuration PKI is non-degenerate if the differential of F tilde with respect to this variable is an isomorphism. Okay. This is the definition of non-degenerate. Why we need all that? Because I said that we will construct a one-parameter family of Riemann surfaces. We'll do that by the implicit function theorem. And so we have to work with map defined between Banach spaces. And we need that the differential with respect to some variables to be an isomorphism. This is the reason. Easiest examples is the following one: nk equal to 1 for each k in z, when nk equal to 1, we want to recover the Riemann example. If nk equal to is equals 1, we have one balanced and non-degenerate configuration given by k times square root of minus 1. It's an easy computation to see that, for example, here we have gk equal 1 over uk. To verify that this application is an isomorphism, I have to compute the derivative of gk with respect to uk. Here we have only the uk because nk equals 1. So uk reduces to the collection of uk, uk plus 1, uk plus 2. And if I replace uk, this value, I find 1. So I have the application F tilde in this case as a differential which is clearly an isomorphism. So this definition works for the Riemann example. Another example. So, nk 1 if k is odd, and nk equal m in z k even. Okay. So that means that if we have one neck here, m necks here, again one neck here, etc. Huh? Mk. So it's not a constant. And mk bounded, it's not infinite. No? For this case, we know perfectly which are the balanced and non-degenerate configurations. I can give the expression, but it's already a quarter past. So we know all the balanced non-degenerate configuration if I choose nk in this way. Okay. I will call special sequences the sequence nk satisfying the following condition. Nk has the following structure, 1, s minus 2, 1, s minus 1, 1, s 0, 1, etc.
Yes, dot, dot,
beginning.
Sorry? Dot, dot, equals, and then dot, dot, dot.
Yes. S L is a finite sequence of numbers strictly bigger than 1, possibly empty. Okay. This is the most general case our this approach works. There is one problem. For this example, we know perfectly which are the balanced non-degenerate configuration. For this one, we are not able to prove the existence of balanced non-degenerate configurations. Okay, so that works for this kind of sequences, is the most general thing we can do. But with respect to this example here, we are not able to prove the existence.
Maybe explicit. Oh, you can't prove existence of the second.
Yes. I if you give me a sequence NK which satisfies all that, I am not sure that there exists PKI, balance and degenerate. Okay, so this is the most general case you can treat with that.
So yeah. Number two, the first part you can prove existence. Number two is good. Number
yes.
three is you're just telling us.
We know nothing.
But if they existed, they would satisfy the non-degeneracy.
Sorry?
Oh, I'm sorry. What are you saying again?
So I said that.
Number two, you can prove existence.
Yes. I know everything.
Yes.
In this case, not always.
Or sometimes you do. Oh.
I mean, if you give me a sequence NK, I am not able to produce PKI balanced and non-degenerate. Always.
You don't know if they exist, or you can't explicitly write them down?
No, no. I don't know if it exists.
Okay.
After this long introduction, theorem. Okay. Let PK0i be a balanced non-degenerate configuration. Where NK is special, that is, NK satisfies all that. Then there exists one parameter family complete embedded minimal surfaces in R3 with infinitely many parallel ends. Okay. Okay. K in Z. Do end. Okay. And K plus one are joined by NK next. This is a statement of a theorem.
Are the ends planar?
Yes.
Do you know if you can, okay, so you don't know how to construct non-planar.
So the problem is, I assume that the configuration exists. we know that it exists in these examples here, but not in this one. So I need to assume the existence of this point. I have only 15 minutes. Okay. The singularization. I will try to explain how we singularize sigma zero. So I remind that sigma zero is a singular Riemann surface. I want to construct a one parameter family of Riemann surfaces and the corresponding immersion. Okay. Okay. We place on SK the points AK1, AK2, okay, sorry. On SK, we place EKI okay. I change a bit the notation to be more detailed. So on SK we place the point AKI and BK minus 1 J. Okay. First step. Second step. We identify AKI with BKI. This lives in SK, and this lives in SK plus 1. We remove the disks given by Z minus AKI. So we remove these disks. We name T this stuff, and we choose them in such a way T is in L infinity Z. Of course, TKI is more. If TKI vanishes, we have a double point. Okay, we identify an annulus around AKI with an annulus around BKI. Following this rule, Z minus AKI times Z minus AKI equal TKI. Z sorry, I forgot to say it before. Z is a local coordinate on SK. Okay? So we have removed such disks, and we have created our next. Okay. Okay, we have desingularized sigma 0. Sigma, the new surface, which depends on T, A, and B, where A is the collection of all that, and B is the collection of the big guy A, is regular Riemann surface. Okay. What about the immersion bdx of x? We have constructed the Riemann surface. We need to construct the immersion. OK, for constructing this one, we have to construct phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. OK, sorry, but I have to introduce other notation. I simplify it as much as possible. OK, we consider I will call C A chi A, the circle, a circle on the neck. Essentially, C is defined by Z minus AKI equal to epsilon, for example. Right? OK, which are the conditions which phi 1, 2, 3 have to satisfy? Period condition. So we have also the some circle near BKI, chi hat equal to 0, and we have of course phi 1 square plus phi 2 square. OK. Let's define phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. We will give a local definition. So on SK, we will have phi 1 equal to the Z plus psi 1, psi 1 holomorphic. No, sorry. I will tell that phi 2 we call Z. Okay, this is our definition of phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3. What are phi 1, psi 1, psi 2, and psi 3? Psi is defined by the integral of So phi 1 is dz plus psi 1, where psi 1 is the differential form defined in this way. We prescribe its periods. Okay, so now we have phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. Okay, the Riemann surface depends on T, A, and B. Phi 1, phi T, and phi 2, sorry, phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3, depend on these coefficients. So our parameters are T, X, A, B, alpha, yeah. I promise not to write down other equations. Okay. Okay, what happens if x equal to 0? X appears here. X is a real number and is the parameter of this family. Okay, if x equal to 0 and tk 1 equal to 0, and alpha k are 0, what we have? We have phi 1 equal to dz, phi 2. These are the bi-stress data. Over plane with normal vector 0. And I remind you that x0 was the immersion of sigma 0 in R3. So these are the bi-stress data of x0. I will not give the detail of construction. So the idea is, when x is not 0 and tki is not 0, so we have a non-singular Riemann surface, we are able to modify the values of these coefficients of aki and bki in such a way so we can adjust the values of alpha kil a b I forgot something? No. In such a way the period condition is verified to Q is 0, so the immersion is minimal in this one. P1 squared. And the immersion is regular. So if we are able to do that, we have that phi 1, phi 2, phi 3 are the Weyl stress data. Or a minimal surface with these properties. I have no time, so. The main tool to do that is the implicit function theorem. So we know that for x equal to 0, tk equal to 0, these are the Weyl stress data of the surface. To show that phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3 defined in this way are the Weyl stress data of these objects, we apply implicit function theorem. I stop here.